Hello, welcome to Macworld. Apple has completely refreshed its iPad lineup. It's brought in the iPad Air 2, it's brought in the iPad Mini 3, and it's got rid of the iPad 4, and it's also changed some of the storage options for the other iPads. The result of all this is that there are now 56 different iPad configurations you can choose from. That might sound intimidating, but don't worry, because in this video, our new iPad guide for autumn winter 2014, we're going to guide you through the whole process of choosing the right iPad for you. Okay, before we get started, let's just look at the different iPads that are currently available. And we've got them in front of us. The five main models are divided into three mini iPads. They're the ones with the 7.9 inch screens. We've got the iPad Mini, the iPad Mini 2, and the iPad Mini 3. And there are two full-sized iPads. That's the iPad Air and the iPad Air 2. Now, for each of these five models, you'll then have to decide how much storage you want. For the oldest iPad Mini 1, you just get 16 gigabytes, but for the other four models, you can choose between 16, 32, 64, and sometimes even 128 gigabytes of storage. After that, you choose which color you want them to come in, black or white, and with the most recent models, you get gold as well. And then finally, you decide if you want 3G or cellular capabilities added onto the Wi-Fi. That makes 56 configuration options. Let's look at the different options individually. So the first decision you need to make is, do you want a big iPad, one of the iPad Airs, or a little iPad, one of the iPad Minis? The overwhelming difference between the two is the screen size that you get. We're talking about a 9.7 inch screen diagonally from corner to corner on the iPad Airs and a 7.9 inch screen on the Minis. 9.7, 7.9, easy to remember. It's not a huge difference. We're talking about roughly the difference between a paperback novel and a hardback. It's about that much extra space. I would say that it makes a big difference if you're watching films with other people. If you want to put a film on your iPad, prop it up on a stand and then sit with your girlfriend or boyfriend and watch a film, the iPad Airs are better for that. But for most other things, the iPad Minis are fine. They're good for gaming, they're good for watching TV shows, and for everyday use, email, browsing the web, they're great. So you just need to think, how much of a sacrifice am I willing to make on screen size? Because the payoff for going for a smaller screen is that you will get a lower price tag by around £80 for equivalent models, and you will get a more portable device. And if you look at this, I can hold it pretty easily in one hand. It's just about pocketable. I wouldn't put it in the pocket of your jeans, I don't think that would work, but it can fit in the pocket of an overcoat, it fits easily in a rucksack, whereas the iPad Airs are just a little bit less portable. The most recent iPad Air is about 6% thinner, about 6% lighter rather, and about 18% thinner than the previous iPad Air, but it's still quite a lot less portable than the minis that are available. Okay, let's say that you've picked a full-sized iPad. If you'd rather have an iPad Mini, you can skip ahead to the next stage in the video. We've got the iPad Air 1 on my right and the iPad Air 2 on my left. They're only a year apart. This is only a year old model, but there are quite a few differences between these. And I think that they more than justify the extra £80 that the equivalent iPad Air 2 will cost you. They're physically different for a start. The iPad Air 2 is about 18, almost 19% thinner. They've somehow managed to shave off an already very thin device into one that's even thinner and a little bit lighter as well. I don't think this makes a huge difference in the day-to-day use of it, because the iPad Air 1 was already so light and so convenient to use. But one of the side effects of this appears to be that because they've taken out the air gaps underneath the screen, then the screen on the iPad Air 2 is actually a little bit less flexible. It's a bit firmer to the touch, and this is actually a bit more pleasant to use. But there are lots of other differences as well. The iPad Air 2 has a faster processor, for one thing. It has the A8X chip rather than the A7 chip. This translates in some of our tests to almost twice as much processing speed. But that's mostly theoretical. Apps at the moment are easy for the iPad Air 1 to deal with because it's already very fast. In the future, as more demanding apps come out, you will start to see a speed boost from using the iPad Air 2 as it's able to use its muscle on the most demanding apps around. With the apps at the moment, I've tried it on some of my most difficult games, and I'm seeing slight delays from the iPad Air 1 compared to the iPad Air 2. It's just very slightly slower at opening some apps and starting apps going. But it doesn't stop there. The camera on the iPad Air 2 is also better. They've increased the megapixel rating from 5 megapixels to 8 megapixels. And they've also added some new features. It gets the time-lapse photography feature, and it gets burst mode, and it gets slow-mo video. And last of all, and I don't think this is a huge thing, but some people will love it, last of all, the iPad Air 2 gets Touch ID, the fingerprint scanner that was on the iPhone 4S. Okay, let's say you've picked an iPad mini. Which of the three iPad minis should you buy? Well, I'm going to give you a spoiler straight away. I think you should get the iPad mini 2, and here's why. There's quite a big difference between the iPad mini 1 and the iPad mini 2. The iPad mini 1 hasn't got a Retina screen. That's the first thing. The 2 and the 3 have. That means they have a pixel density rating of 326 compared to the iPad mini 1's 163. They are, by that measure, about twice as sharp. You won't see that in every app you use, but on anything with a lot of detail, anything with text, you will tend to see that the iPad mini 1 is noticeably less sharp. The iPad mini 2 is also significantly faster than the iPad mini 1. In our tests, it seemed to be about 4 times as quick for general processing and up to 8 times as fast for graphical processing. This means that the iPad mini 2 and the iPad mini 3, which has the same processor chip as the iPad mini 2, will both be a lot better for any kind of gaming or any moderately demanding apps that you want to use them for. The iPad mini 1 is fine for email, browsing the web, light gaming, those sort of things. But anything more ambitious than that, you need to be looking at the iPad mini 2 or 3. So those are the things that the iPad mini 2 does better than the iPad mini 1. And remember that you're only talking about an extra £40 for the equivalent iPad mini 2. It's quite a small jump up financially, but because of the screen difference and the processor difference, you're getting a considerably better device. And what about the jump up from the iPad mini 2 to the brand new iPad mini 3? Well, it's a larger financial difference. It's an extra £80. And the actual differences are much smaller. Essentially, the only thing that's different about the iPad mini 3 is that it gets the Touch ID fingerprint sensor. Now, some people will love that. The fingerprint sensor is quite cool, let's be honest, and it's also potentially quite convenient because third-party apps can now use it. You can unlock password protection apps using your fingerprint, and that's pretty cool. But is it worth £80? Other than that, they're the same. The camera is the same, the screen is the same, and the processor chip is the same. So I think I would say, if you want an iPad mini, you should probably be looking at the iPad mini 2. So that's all the main options covered. If you're looking for a big screen, clearly you need to get one of the iPad Airs. But you're going to pay extra money and you're going to get a less portable device. So do try and think hard about whether you're able to sacrifice a little bit of screen size and get a cheaper, more portable device. If you want an iPad Air, then think about how important Touch ID and raw processing power is to you. You won't see a lot of speed difference between the two devices for a while yet. But if you're very into the latest games and you plan to download a lot of the latest games over the coming months, you'll start to find that the iPad Air 2 is the best option. Of the minis, in almost every case, I would suggest the iPad mini 2. If you want something that is a pure bargain, then the iPad mini 1 is just £199. And it's fine for very basic, very light use. But if you want to do anything at all ambitious, I would go for the iPad mini 2. And the iPad mini 3 is hard to recommend unless Touch ID is a deal breaker. beyond that, you'll need to think about the amount of storage you want. And I would strongly recommend at least 32 gigabytes if that is available. For the newer models, you might want to go as high as 64 because they've taken out the 32 gigabyte stage. 16 gigabytes you can manage with, but only if you have a relatively small number of apps, preferably not games as well, because on average they tend to be larger. And you would also need to keep most of your photos, videos and music in the cloud. And what about 3G cellular capabilities? They're about £100 extra, and you may find that you don't need them very often. What it means is that when you're away from Wi-Fi, when you're on the train, for example, then you'll still be able to access your emails and access the internet. And that's quite convenient, but is it worth £100? How often are you actually going to use that? I would often say to people, you'll probably be able to manage without. And last of all, which colour do you want to go for? The most conservative ones are the white and the black, but the new gold option is actually, surprisingly, quite nice. If we have a quick look at the iPad Air 2, which we've got here, this is the gold finish. And as you can see, it's almost a rose gold. It's a bit bronzy, it's quite warm. And we actually think it's really nice. And that covers the 56 options. I hope this has been helpful. For reviews of all of the individual iPad models, tutorials on how to use the iPads, general buying advice, and everything you need to know as an iPad owner, come to macworld.co.uk.